So it feels so wonderful to be here in this room after this fresh coat of paint has been applied to the walls and the ceiling. And we have the dream of replacing the floor someday, and also the dream of building one day, and the dream of building a wall where the stage used to be, and then that'll be a place for keeping equipment. And so this is our building is becoming more and more beautiful. So great thanks to Carol Ann, who took a real leadership in this, and Tom and Jeff Way, who did painting with Dave Gorey, and others as well. So this morning, just so grateful to have the projector back. I didn't know that we didn't have it, so you know, I came waltzing into church and going, ah, yes, we have to improvise. And then it turns out that, hi, Tracy.
Hello, dear. Hey, Tracy.
Great to see you. So then I thought we'd begin with a video, and then I'm just gonna lead in one song that we can all sing together, and then have a little talk that we can share in, and then a video at the end. So that's how the service will go. So please feel free to get coffee anytime you like, and let's start. This first song is one that I do every once in a while, and I do it is just I choose it because. But several reasons. One is I love it. It's a tribute to Rich Mullins, who I think was one of the most unusual of the Christian musicians. Somebody that I loved his perspective on life, and I think he was the person who was more dedicated to the message that he was trying to bring than to performance, although his performance levels were very high. And he wrote some beautiful songs. This one's called Creed. And the story behind this is that a band called Third Day loved his music. And they were playing at a city in California where one of our graduates lived. And they met him at a recording studio, and they realized that he played the hammer dulcimer. And you can't really do some of the Rich Mullins music without this instrument. So these guys did a stadium concert for the city, and then they phoned him after midnight, and they said, "We just thought maybe it'd be fun to meet with you and to do a song to honor Rich Mullins, who had died by that point, and do you want to come and record with us through the night?" So this is a recording made spontaneously by a band called Third Day, with a Christian singer named Brandon Heath, who had joined with them in the concert. And then our student, Garrett Biggers. So, and Garrett was one of the, at the time, Garrett was one of the best known hammer dulcimer players in the United States. So he was here for our worship program. So here's the video. It's called Creed. There's a nice moment actually right at the end there where they all go. No problem. So one of the most creative services that we ever had involved Garrett. So he was here, and Dan Wills had a hammer dulcimer too, and I think it's the only Sunday. I'm not sure, but I think it just so happened that there was a Sunday that I couldn't speak. I got laryngitis on Saturday, and I thought there's no time to just ask anybody to speak tomorrow. You know, it's not a very good notice. And so I got laryngitis on Saturday, but I knew that Joel Mason had written a poem about Brandon, about small boat, in a small boat on a big sea. And so he had written about a 20-minute long poem. And so I just said, Joel, how do you feel about doing that poem tomorrow? Oh, he was away at the time. I found him, tracked him down, and he said that he would do it. So then it just so happened that Garrett was here and had taken part in the worship that morning, in the worship music. So then, I don't know who made the suggestion, but anyway, it might have been Joel. But Joel did his poem, and Garrett just sat up beside him, and although he'd never heard the poem before, this 20-minute poem, he played his dulcimer all the way through it. And just gave it shades of meaning, and you know, made it. It was just added beauty to this, to the poem, which was already beautiful. So it was one of our great, great experiences, and it just happened because of laryngitis, which is so often the way. Eh? The thing you don't expect ends up adding beauty. So I loved, Jess, you put a beautiful post up last week after a service. We had two great services. We just recently had one with David Moore speaking, and one with Brad Jerzak. And we had musicians for both of them, and so and both services were a little bigger than we have been doing, and it felt like almost felt like church again. and then you said it was so nice that we sang the doxology together. That, you know, I think our hearts were open because of whatever had been going on, whatever we were talking about, and we all just sang it like as though we meant it more than anything. And I thought, gee, we don't have musicians this week, but at least maybe I'll just lead in an old chorus so that we can sing together. So I thought about Breathe, because I just happened to see the music for it a week or so ago, and realized that I loved this once years ago. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very words spoken to me, and the air I breathe. your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me, and I am desperate for So, Lord, we thank you for the beauty of this day and the chance to gather together, and we ask that you help everyone in our world who is struggling with COVID to breathe. And I think in particular of David Moore, who was here for 2 weeks, and really the first time that he's ventured out of his home in two weeks, and learned that he had COVID soon after he got home, and afraid for him, pray that it would be quickly over. And Sophie, our granddaughter, and so many others. Bill just told me that Arlene had it recently. Lord, we ask that everyone be able to walk free without further breathing problems. And we pray for wise ways for the world to show compassion, reorganize, deal with everything that needs to be done to walk free from the ongoing repercussions of this disease. We pray for Ukraine. Pray for the restraint of restraining of evil and violence, and pray for corridors, safe corridors for refugees to escape. We pray for welcome all over the world. We pray for the end of this war and the rebuilding of Ukraine. We pray for the end of the kind of nation-state maneuver that allows this sort of thing to happen. We pray that we'll emerge into a wiser and better place as humans. Yeah. So many stories. We ask for your presence and your spirit to invade story after story after story, to bring peace and healing somehow. I guess this is a form of daily bread to bring our heart's concerns to you. And I know Pete loves it when we do the Lord's Prayer. So, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Yeah, Pete.
I want to thank God for our friends from Cal's coming over.
Yeah.
It seems like a real home here. Everyone together.
Suddenly a real home. Everyone together. It's Jeannie and Tracy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, Cal's. I mean, it was like we were cut off.
Yeah.
It was like we were cut off. Wow. Wonderful. Yeah, Jeannie.
Yeah, I'd like some prayer. My nephew's made some really bad choices that he's paying for them now, or just at the very cusp of doing that, but there's repercussions for his family and beyond, and so asking for prayer.
Okay. Just what's the first name for him?
Justin.
Okay. Lord, you know the ins and outs of this situation with Justin, and you know the pain and his family and everyone watching, the people that have been hurt. So we invite you to come into it. We invite you. I don't believe that you plan these things for us, but I do believe that you're a genius at working rich and better results than we could have imagined. So I ask that all over this situation that better results could come. A few weeks ago, we were looking at the book of Daniel, and it says that there will be a time when many people will fall by the sword or by famine. People, you know, terrible things will happen, but it says, but there will be a little help. And that's what I just find this phrase is on my heart as I think about Ukraine or think about something like this family situation. What does the little help look like? Please, could you creatively bring the little help? The thing that makes, at least in retrospect, when people look back and say that this could have been worse and it turned into something which I'm actually partly grateful for. Not that I would have chosen this path. Anything else?
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah, thanks so much. Yeah, last week we prayed for Ray. His dad's been placed in hospice, and Rosie's out there this week in Alberta too with Ray. And do you know, it's just so sad. Those guys were here maybe 4 or 5 years ago, and just, you know, just happily visiting Ray and Rosie, his parents, and then went home, and his dad had an accident in his truck. And really, I think the last number of years have been defined by that accident. And now he's near the end of his life. And Ray says, we don't know whether it's days or months, but it's, you know, and he is being made comfortable. But so we just ask for you to be near. Lord, could we have a little help for Ray and Rosie and for Ray's mom and the family in every way, and for Ray's dad. Yeah, and we were walking through a death situation with a loved one, and we just pray for a little help there too. Spring flowers. Okay, so nice to be together, and that felt quite lovely. I mean, I think the thing you said, Jess, in that post about the singing together made me think, so important to do. You know, it's just so important to. Did you guys sing on that song that I was singing? I didn't really hear you.
We sung inside.
Behind our masks. But I think it's very important to do if we can. And sometimes it's been harder to find musicians during this period of time. But maybe that's one thing we can always do. We can always find someone that will lead us in a song or two. And maybe we shouldn't forget the beauty of singing together. Yeah. There's something about the opening of the heart, you know, that can, yeah. Okie dokie. So, I have a talk. Well, I think it's okay for these notes to go up. Did you have the words to the song? Did Walt project the words to the song?
No.
Well done. So this is, I have this sort of, very, very often I have to speak on Sunday, if not here, somewhere, although that sort of sure hasn't been happening in the last few years. My dream is to try to bring something that seems alive to me. So I have like this 35 or 36 year tradition of saying through the week, Lord, what would you like me to say this week? And you know, sometimes I end up with a story where it feels like, there was some level of inspiration. Other times you just don't know. But I'm always asking, and what seems to happen very often is that I have an idea that will seem, you know, it's just from my work, but it just seems so alive. It seems to have an extra quality of life. It's you know, whatever ideas have been bandying around the university that week, in my classes or in my reading or in conversations, it's like something is alive. And then it seems like another part to it comes, and that's alive. And I look for the ideas that have that special quality of life, and then out of that forge some kind of a message, usually most weeks. Anyway, this week I had the experience, which I sometimes do, of saying, Lord, what would you like me to speak on this week? I said it on Monday, nothing. Tuesday, nothing. Wednesday, you see where this is going. So Saturday, this is what, I finally sat down at my computer, and this is what I wrote, Creator God. I actually said, love of my life. But then I thought, well, you know, maybe Marilyn would be jealous. And I said, I don't know what to talk about tomorrow, and you are being very quiet. Anything important to say? And it was so interesting that I immediately had this just ideas just popping like crazy, and they hadn't been there. Like, they weren't there when I took showers, which is when they normally come, or on walks. You know, it was just like nothing. But then when I sat down at the computer, Creator God, You've been very quiet this week. It's like, if this is a partnership, one of us is holding up his end, and it's not you. Yeah. And, you know, I know how, I'm just being playful, because I don't mean to be dishonoring to the source of all life. But I do think it's okay to be playful. And so I'm saying this, and immediately I thought about the word deconstruction, and what Brad has been talking about it a lot in the times that he's been here, and he wrote a book about it recently, and I think maybe two, and he says, you know, in the church world, it's as though there's been this sort of breaking out of a normal way of thinking. It's like wherever you're talking to people, people are saying, I'm deconstructing my faith. I'm seeing all kinds of seminaries are holding seminars about deconstruction because all the people in the churches are talking about it. It's like we just don't believe the same things the same way anymore, and we just can't make ourselves. And to, the thing that makes it worse is that the very, very vocal groups in Christianity so often don't stand for what you believe. You know, the groups that are in the news all the time seem homophobic. They seem exclusive. They very often seem so right-wing, it's very hard to relate to them. And not in a centrist position. I can easily honor a right-wing perspective or a left-wing perspective if it's reasonable and can dialogue with views that are on the other side. It's very hard to do that when people are way over on one side or the other. So the churches seem to be representing views that I just go, I just not in a million years would I ever want to stand for anything like that. So I really get this exodus away from institutional Christendom. Personally, it makes sense to me, and it's happening everywhere. And except for places, I shouldn't say it's happening everywhere, it's happening in many, many places. But so Brad says, the thing with the word deconstruction, though, you know, where people are saying, I just don't believe the same things that I used to in the same way. The problem with that is, he says it's such a violent word. It's like a word that's like sweeping everything clean. He said, wouldn't it be better if we had a better metaphor? Could it be like a kitchen renovation? You know, could it, because we're talking about something that is so precious to us, something so beautiful, means so much, which is our faith, our longing and our sense of meaning, the thing that draws us into community. You know, could it be something, could we have a better metaphor? Could it be like a garden that's being reworked? You know, maybe it's been fallow for a time and now we're gonna bring it back to life. And I love this thinking. I think that's good. Let's recognize both things, that there's a treasure and also there's a need for something to be transformed or something new. So here's the next thing that I wrote. You can see this. I don't mean for you to think that this, you know, I left that first part, Creator God, I don't know what to talk about tomorrow. Is there anything important to say? I don't mean for you to think that this is an answer from God, the stuff that I start writing. You know, oh, there's so much about deconstruction. Brad's got a good point. That wasn't God speaking. That was an idea that... that was an idea that jumped into my head. Same thing here. I laughed as a, you know, I worry about the next generation. This is not the Lord speaking. I don't think the Lord's worried about the next generation. So I personally worry about the next generation. As they find new forms of spirituality, they might be leaving behind a treasure. Intimacy with God through the words and works of Jesus and the gift of the Holy Spirit's presence, as well as the great value of an intergenerational community seeking beauty and meaning together and doing practical acts of love. You know, I don't know if you, this is the thing that seems to me to be this such priceless treasure. Look at over the years, you know, how many times we've laughed at a child or at someone who said something clever in the midst of a gathering, or, you know, or how many times was there something beautiful, or how many times, were people all ready when there was a practical need and a group was able to go and help? How many times? I feel like this is a beautiful way to do life together. And as people walk away from institutional Christianity, which I get, I'm just afraid that there won't be a beautiful enough replacement for this, you know, for organic communities that gather because they want to seek the heart of all that is and give appropriate praise and worship to God, the source of life, and learn how to be transformed themselves into the best people that they can be, you know? So that's what I'm hoping, that somehow a merger is found with the past and with the new that will come. So today, I just thought I'd look at two great passages of scripture, one from the Old Testament, one from the New, and I'll just share my thoughts, but I'd love it if you would share yours. And then I've got a poem by the 13th century mystic Rumi. I've often brought poems by him, a Muslim Sufi, whirling dervish kind of poet, Rumi, and one of the great wise people in the world's history. And then I've got a lovely familiar passage from C.S. Lewis and a couple of other quips from Rumi. So I just thought I'd just share these ideas and see if we can get some kind of conversation going. So the first one, I think in the whole Old Testament, this may be my favorite passage. It's from Jeremiah 17. And it's just a contrast of the person who's going to seek their strength in human flesh, or the person who's going to seek their strength in God's life. And it's Jeremiah 17, 5-8. And it starts like this. Thus says the Lord, cursed is the one who trusts in mankind, makes flesh his strength, whose heart turns away from the Lord. He'll be like a bush in the desert, will not see when prosperity comes, but will live in stony wastes in the wilderness, a land of salt without inhabitant. The contrast is, blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose trust is the Lord. This person will be like a tree planted by the water that extends its roots by a stream, will not fear when the heat comes. Its leaves will be green, it will not be anxious in a year of drought, nor cease to yield fruit. I've often felt as though this one little passage, Jeremiah 17, 5-8, explains what we do here. It explains a whole life. You almost don't need the rest of the Bible. That's what I felt. You know, if you could just understand this passage, you basically wouldn't need very much more than this. If the source of your strength is just human, if you're not learning how to participate with the Spirit of God, if you're not being transformed, and if you're not depending on the strength of God, then the thing is that you could acquire everything that you want to, you could achieve everything you want to, but you would lose the childlike capacity of wonder. You would lose the capacity to delight in the thing that you've achieved. In other words, your inner life will dry up. You'd be like a bush in the wilderness. Have you ever seen tumbleweed out west? You know, you ever seen tumbleweed bouncing along the road? And if you're driving through Arizona or Utah or something like that, there's just not enough sap to keep something anchored. And so this is what happens, is that people who only have humanity as strength, and personally, I don't think that's bad. I'm fully invested in loving what's human. But on the other hand, if you don't have your inner life continually being renewed by the source of life, then what's going to happen is that you'll dry up, and you could become famous, wealthy, everything, and still be, you have lost the childlike capacity to delight in that which you've achieved. And we see this all the time, people with great success and yet great unhappiness. And it's somewhere along the way, they lost the flow of life that they need on the inside that keeps everything fresh and new, full of wonder and delight. Better to be delighted at the smallest things. Don't you think, like, wouldn't it be wonderful if your delight didn't cost you a Rembrandt painting every time? You know, because you can only pull that off every few years, unless you're very wealthy. And so, wouldn't it be better if you were delighted by the tiniest things? Like, you see something, like, look at that caterpillar. Isn't it wonderful? That's far better, because what we really care for is not wealth or fame. What we care for is delight. And that's the thing that we so easily lose when we're not connected to the source of life. So then the last part is the exact opposite. Blessed, how blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, connected to the flow of life. Like a tree planted by water extends its roots by a stream, will not fear when heat comes. Its leaves will be green, it won't even be anxious in a year of drought. In other words, all kinds of bad circumstances could happen to you if you're connected to the source of life, but you'll still find something rich. You'll find a way to grow. Does it make sense? What did you guys see in this passage? Anything else?
I just get amazed at the connection between services. In the readings this morning, there was a passage about from an indigenous person responding to the Pope's apology.
Okay.
And then there was a podcast. Did he say he was anchored in joy, the way that people took things? It was something like that.
I can't remember
if that was the exact phrase, but that was my take on it. This person in a podcast was talking about, you know, all the hardships that they went through and everything, but how his perspective was anchored in joy, and you just used that word anchor, you know, and how when we let ourselves be anchored and rooted in him, it's just, I'm just enjoying this connection. That's all.
Wow. But we talked about it late into the night to try to make it happen. That's a lie. But it is wonderful. It's very often it does feel as though there's a flow that goes through the whole community as we try to do meaning together.
Yeah.
Very often musicians, people that pray, people that design one service, people that design another, all sense the same kinds of things in it. And even the same kinds of words come out sometimes.
Yeah.
Sometimes the same scriptures are used without anybody knowing. And I think, and you know, years ago, we used to sort of connect with all the other churches around that had a worship team, and that was just about every church. And we would find that, you know, most of us were singing some of the same songs each weekend. And it's almost like a big mind going, that's St. Stephen. Oh, they need to seek ye first the kingdom of God. Oh, which kind of reminded me, the funny voice reminded me, the best meme I've ever seen of 27 seconds on Facebook. Brian Mesker posted this. It's a conversation. Jerry Seinfeld is in a cafe with Norm Macdonald, a comedian that died recently. And the two are sitting in the cafe. And Norm Macdonald says to Jerry Seinfeld, he goes, but it's easier for you because you don't have any children. He goes, what? He goes, I've got three children. He goes, what, three daughters? He goes, no, I've got a girl and two sons. And he goes, well, agree to disagree, but, and Brian Metzger goes, have you ever been in conversations like this? I'm still having trouble negotiating them. Here's one comedian says to the other, he says, well, you don't have any children. I've got a girl and two sons. Well, agree to disagree. I don't know, I thought it was the most hilarious thing I'd seen in weeks. Okay, so I had a friend who was a very gifted artist who told me that just about everybody is highly creative, scores on a highly creative scale before they go to school. But after they go to school, most people learn how to think in conventional ways. You know, my friend was an artist, and he said he once got a friend's son, who was about five, to draw. He said, draw something for me. And what he drew was hard to discern. You know, he said, could you explain it to me? He said, it's a car. And but it turned out he had painted a car the way that he sees it from the back seat. So he had driven it from, he had painted it from the inside. And so that was just highly creative, and my friend was delighted with this. But the next, he was 2 years later, and he visited, and the little boy had been to school. And so he said, draw something for me. And he drew a little square house with a little peaked roof and a chimney and a little bit of, and he went, oh no, they got him. You know, it's just, the as soon as we get into these machinations of education, there's something that can really take away from our uniqueness and our unique perspectives, and we all learn to conform. So apparently everybody scores really, really high in creativity early on in life. Only a small percentage of people do later in life. So I'm thinking it has something to do with this verse. I think it has something to do with how well we remain connected to the source of life. I think childlike wonder, delight in simple things, I think the the gift of creativity, I think all these things really have to do with being connected to the source of life. And so instead of curse, don't think of that in sort of some kind of violent that way. Just think, oh, how too bad when somebody doesn't know this and they are only drawing out of their own strength. Oh, how too bad. Because after a while, you dry up. You dry up so much that you lose your capacity to delight even if you become successful. So it really shows us the importance of this, eh? Let's go to the next passage. This is one of my faves. It's in the New Testament. Basically, if you just had this, you wouldn't need anything else in the Bible. Wait a minute. Philippians 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I'll say rejoice. Let your gentle spirit be known to everybody. The Lord is near. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. I just couldn't leave that part out, but it's not what I want to talk about. It's this next part. Finally, brethren and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute, if there's any excellence in anything worthy of praise, dwell on these things. The things you've learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things and the God of peace will be with you. Before I say anything about this, what do you think? Just read it again maybe for yourself, and then I'd love to have some comments. Especially from the second part. Yeah.
Just before church, Marilyn and I were talking, and she was talking about one of your kids back in New Brunswick, and she said, due to COVID, so even as horrible that COVID has been worldwide, there are a few little good things that have happened as a result. Actually, if you really look at it, there's been quite a few, and I think not to disregard the suffering that people are having, but generally, if you look for that little bit of good in anything, you can find it.
Wait, oh, you're right. In our case, our children that were very, very far away from home just couldn't stand that COVID made it impossible to get home to be with us and with my daughter-in-law's family, our daughter-in-law's family. So in the end, that brought them home to be closer to all of us. That was a great joy for our family. And you're right, in little ways and in big ways, it's true that in the midst of this difficult time, there are things to appreciate. There's always something lovely to find. Or not always, but often. Yeah. Shouldn't say always. Yeah. But often. I had to learn how to do my work in a completely different way, and now I'm very grateful for it.
I just have a little story about this passage. So,
do you want to just come in?
No.
But would you do it if we twisted your arm? I mean, it just—it seems like if you're going to tell a story, you might as well be here.
I'm good right here. I'll talk a little louder. Thank you, though. When I was about 13 or 14, I had, you know, a small period of my life where I was maybe a little bit rude to my parents.
Oh,
like, no. I know. And to the point, my response to everything was, whatever. Whatever. To the point where my mom banned that word to come from my mouth as if it was a swear word. Like, I wasn't allowed to say it. But for my 8th grade graduation, she got me this stone word, whatever, and it had this passage written on it throughout it. So, very cheeky on her part, but also,
cheeky.
Like, I ever since then, because I was still, like, it was in that period of time where I wasn't allowed to use that word, but she gave me a Bible passage that used the word quite often.
Whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right.
Yeah.
Oh, you're quite.
It was just so good, but it's been because of that, and since, like, that's the thing that made it become, like, a Bible memory verse for me, right? Like, I have remembered it ever since, and it has become one of my favorite passages to come back to. But then I also sit a little bit in it, chuckling at, like, that teenage dynamic with my mom. I also embroidered a sweater the next year with that word on it.
That's amazing.
It was an ongoing thing.
That is just hilarious.
The good thing that came from it is I cherish this passage so much. From that memory with my mom, but also just, like, the words of that passage, I just...
Yeah.
I love it so much.
So you remind me that this is silly, but Mary Ellen and I both went for blood work this week and on Thursday morning. And we had to wait outside the door to be able to get into the hospital. And Mary Ellen found this little keychain without a key on it, but the tag for a keychain, and it said Peter. It was, and then when you turned it over, it was like plastic, hard plastic, it said Peter, and then it had a word, sort of an adjective that went along with every letter. It was powerful, efficient, tactful, elegant, romantic. And I thought, you know, 1 out of 5 isn't bad. And darling. And so I just, yeah, it's just lovely what your story. Thank you. What about what else do you see in it? For me, I love Plato's Republic. I've been teaching it this term, and I've read it again several times this year, getting ready for that. And I just find that Plato has a longing for justice, or Socrates does, who's the main figure in the book. Plato writes about Socrates, his mentor. And Socrates has a longing for justice, and he thinks that you'll never have justice if you don't have the right leaders for a city. He thinks you'll never have justice unless you have the best leaders. And he also thinks you'll never have peace in a human being unless you have the best part of you leading. He thinks that humans have, you know, reason and emotion and appetite. And he thinks that if emotion leads the way, you're in trouble. And if appetite leads the way, you're definitely in trouble. But if reason leads the way, the others will fall into their proper place. So he's thinking about this, and he's thinking about how do we develop people to be the best that they can be? And he comes up with just about something almost exactly like these last verses. He thinks that the people that will be the guardians of a city They need to fall in love with what goodness is. They need to love it so much that they're studying it, thinking about it, imbibing it. Goodness, they have to love goodness, they have to love justice, they have to love beauty, they have to love compassion. And as they love those things, he's pretty convinced that they will be changed from the inside out. He thinks that they'll be changed, not like a parent that has to sort of give external guidelines to a child for a time until, well, I mean, at a certain point, if you give external guidelines, you hope that the child will make it interior, and the child will know not to cross the street when cars are coming, you know? So you're really hoping that it all becomes interior. Well, that is exactly what he's hoping for the leaders, that the leaders will love goodness so much that they'll become interiorly focused on goodness. And it's like the more that you study that which is good, the more you become good from the inside out. And I think this is really the story. This is what Christian transformation offers. You know, the more that you love Jesus, the more you love what Jesus does, the more that you love the way Jesus interacts with others, the way that Jesus interacts, the way that Jesus participates with the Spirit of God, the good things that happen, the more that you love that, the more that you can be changed by it and act it out in your life. The more that you learn how to forgive when you've been hurt, the more that you learn how to speak the truth in a situation where powerful blocks are doing the wrong thing. The more that you study Jesus, the more that you go, I don't understand it, but I'm becoming like that. So it's a way for us to be connected to the source. If the passage in the Old Testament was telling us that we need to be connected to the source, perhaps this passage is giving us a secret about how we might do that. By loving the best, by loving the good, by focusing on that. It's like stretching our heart out and opening it so that a river of life can go through us. Do you know what I'm saying? If you focus all the time on bitterness, if you focus all the time on complaint, if you focus all the time on anger, it's like you've closed off the opening places for your life. And this creativity that you so desperately need, this childlike wonder and delight, it just can't flow through you. Does that make sense? So here's a way that, this is a practical way that you could start to become something that's better, to become more like Christ. And here's the poem by Rumi. Rumi has a poem about deconstruction. It comes to a different conclusion, but I think it's worth reading. I better check the time. Holy smokes. I guess we don't have time for it. There's no time for, oh, we started late. That's right, we were just, yeah, we had to get the projector. Okay, so we'll be here for the next 2 hours. Here's Rumi's poem, The Pickaxe. Some commentary on I was a hidden treasure and I desired to be known. And I didn't check, but I think that must go back to an earlier poem. This is what Rumi says, though. Tear down this house. 100,000 new houses can be built from the transparent yellow carnelian buried beneath it. Carnelian is a gemstone, really valued. Some people think it even has healing properties, but it was loved in the ancient East. So 100,000 new houses can be built from the transparent yellow carnelian buried beneath it, and the only way to get to that is to do the work of demolishing and then digging under the foundations. With that value in hand, all the new construction will be done without effort. And anyway, sooner or later, the house is going to fall down on its own. The jewel treasure will be uncovered, but it won't be yours then. The buried wealth is your pay for doing the demolition, the pick and shovel work. If you wait and just let it happen, you'd bite your hand and say, I didn't do as I knew I should have. This is a rented house. You don't own the deed. You have a lease, and you've set up a little shop where you barely make a living sewing patches on torn clothing. Yet only a few feet underneath are two veins, pure red and bright gold carnelian. Quick, take the pickaxe and pry the foundation. You gotta quit this seamstress work. What does the patch sewing mean, you ask? Eating and drinking. The heavy cloak of the body is always getting torn. You patch it with food and other restless ego satisfactions. Rip up one board from the shop floor and look into the basement, you'll see two glints in the dirt. What do you think it means? It's almost like a riddle, I think. That's definitely one thing. You have to do it. You have to take what's not good enough yet and knock it down and do the renovation work. Yeah. Because I'm...
Sometimes there's no choice but to carry on the quest to uncover what needs to be.
Okay, I want to say it exactly. I think what you said is priceless. Say it again. Sometimes...
There's no choice.
Sometimes there's no choice. You have to tear down what was.
So that you can uncover what needs to be.
So that you can uncover what needs to be. Thank you. Wow. I feel like you said that very well. I think that for Plato, and maybe for St. Paul, the sense is that if we can just look, it's almost like looking outward. For the good. For Rumi, he's saying deep down your everyday life, your eating and your drinking and all your other concerns, you spend so much of your time doing stuff that doesn't really matter. And he's saying deep down beneath it, there's something priceless. There's gemstones, priceless, that would provide more wealth than you could tear the whole thing down and start over if you could get to your true self, the best part of you. So we won't look exactly in the same place as maybe St. Paul was thinking or Plato was thinking, but we'll look deep within our being. And we'll think, gee, an awful lot of our life is just going through, just doing the same thing. It's the hamster treadmill. But there's something beneath it that's just priceless. Could we get to that? And if we could get to that, everything would be changed. There'd certainly be enough value to rebuild the thing easily. Nice picture, eh? That one's very, very close to something that C.S. Lewis said famously in the Weight of Glory sermon. We are half-hearted creatures fooling about with drink and sex and ambition when infinite joy is offered us, like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in a slum because he can't imagine what's meant by the offer of a holiday at the sea. We are far too easily pleased. It's almost like sometimes we're holding on to something so tightly, but we'll need to open our hand to let it go in order to receive something brand new. But it's hard to do. It's just so hard to do. Because it may not be the best, but it feels comfortable, secure. Sometimes you have to open your hand and let things go. And here's another quip from Rumi, two more. I love this. This is in a poem called A Two-Headed Thing. The sun says to the unripe grape, there's a kitchen inside you where you can make vinegar, or if I help, sweet juice. And then this one from a poem called How We Move in Grace. Satisfaction comes from God, but to get there you need to eat bread. Beauty comes from the presence. But those of us in bodies must walk in a garden to feel it. When this body medium goes, we will see directly the light that lives in the chest. The qualities of water show how we move inside grace. That I shouldn't probably have included that last line because it relates to a lot of other things in the poem. But the first part, satisfaction comes from God, but to get there, you need to eat bread. Beauty comes from the presence, but those of us in bodies must walk in a garden to feel it. When this body medium goes, we'll see directly the light that lives in the chest. And maybe the other part is too otherworldly. I thought it'd be really nice to include this part. You know, we do exist in bodies, and we have to negotiate our way in this world. We have to find out the way to do it. But how beautiful if we can do it with an eye to the treasure. To be real about who we are as humans, to enjoy that, but to have a heart that opens to the source of life, to the fountain of life, so that we can be transformed. And so here's my conclusion. There's a treasure that's not our own. It will give us strength to live. We can be transformed. If we look a little deeper than the needs of comfort, we will find the call of God. We can study the real and become real as we do. Perhaps Plato is right that goodness is a form in an invisible world that we've all come from and where we hope to return. Perhaps Rumi is right that the real is hidden deep within us. Either way, we shouldn't rest until we set our sights on transformation. Let that be the upward call toward heaven, to become our best self as we participate with God in all of life. That's all for the meditation for today, unless someone of you has something you would like to add. Okay, so I have one beautiful song to close with. It's a steep bell. And it's the lovely song, Here by the Water, I'll Build an Altar to Praise You. It's from one of his early albums. I just love this song. And I guess we'll just close with that.
Hey, Barry. Sorry I can't be with you in Cannon Beach during the conference, but I know you wanted me to do this song, and it fits apparently into your teaching on Genesis 26 about building altars by waters. And so here it is. Going
go.